So, let me share the results here. There is quite some spread here. And for this quiz, I would also like to... It's important that you understand the meaning of or how to interpret confidence intervals and how to interpret statements like this. So I think it's really important that we have this, that we really clarify this. So I will go through all the suggested answers here, and discuss them. And so if you can give feedback here on them, either by chat or by audio, that would be good, so that we really interact a little bit here. So let's look at statement number A. So first of all, is the screen size okay? Should I increase the magnification, or is it okay? For whom is it too small to properly read? Maybe I should have asked this earlier. Anybody too small on the screen? Okay, no. Okay, statement A. 95% of all asteroids have a bulk density between 1.67. So I guess I miscalculated here. So this number is funny. That should be 70 here, I guess. Because it doesn't add up properly. Is this equivalent to this statement? So the answer is no. This is the solution, or this is the reasoning for the solution. What we have here is the mean value of our sample plus minus some standard error. And the central limit theorem states that for a given level of significance, here 95%, for a sample of that size, 95% of the time, the true asteroid bulk density will be within this interval. So there is something like a mean bulk density. Which is some number, it is unknown. And the densities of all asteroid densities of all asteroids are distributed with a certain true mean and a certain true sigma, and they are within when we look around the mean. With two standard deviations, this covers about 95% of all asteroid densities. But this is the standard error of our sample, yeah, which is computed as a function of the sample size. So A is wrong. What about B? If you have questions, just type them in the chat or interrupt me so that we really can make sure that everybody understands. Statement B, 95% of random samples of 20 asteroids will yield a confidence interval that contain the true average bulk density of asteroids. So this is the solution. The interpretation from the lecture notes of a confidence interval is, if this is the confidence interval, that means we are confident that about 95% of random samples will have sample means that are within two standard errors of the population mean. So we have a 95% chance that the true mean density of asteroids is somewhere in this range. And it is important to note that this corresponds to confidence intervals that are based off random samples of 20 asteroids. When we have differently sized samples, then the standard error changes and the size of the confidence interval changes. Yeah. So when you give a measurement like this, and then of course this is the uncertainty, but you are not giving the uncertainty of your sample mean, because the uncertainty of your sample mean is zero. The uncertainty of your sample mean value is just the result of the measured values. There is no uncertainty on that. The uncertainty is on how far your sample or your measurement is from the true population value. And I had this interactive numerical experiment in the lecture video where I had these 100 lines that corresponded to confidence intervals of 100 samples, and where we saw that a couple of these 100 confidence intervals were actually not including the true underlying population mean. And that's also, I think, was one of the exercises to reproduce this. So if you successfully covered the did the exercise, you should have a relatively good understanding of what a confidence interval means. So this is the meaning here. Let's look at the other two statements. So 95% of the time, the true average bulk density of asteroids is between 1.7 and 2.82. So that's of course nonsense, because if there is a true bulk density of asteroids, it is a number and it doesn't change. So either it's in this range or it isn't. And it's not only 95% of the time. And D, we are 95% confident that asteroids in this sample have a bulk density on average of 1.7 to 2.82 gram per cubic centimeter. This is of course also nonsense, because we have sample densities and we know exactly what their bulk densities are, because we measured them. So there is no confidence on where the sample things are. So this is of course also nonsense. But okay, I understand that this is kind of also a semantic problem to like converting this statement into natural language. But that's exactly what you need to do or need to be able to do. So again, B is the correct answer. And this is the meaning of this statement here on how the sample mean is distributed according to the central limit theorem. Please be aware that this requires the knowledge of a standard error, and the standard error needs to know somehow the sigma. And that's not necessarily easy. Okay. Are there questions to this question? No. Okay. Then let's move on to number two. Let's have it like this. I think this is also from the lecture notes where we were talking on p-value. So we have 200 observations randomly sampled from a stellar survey. And the same stars are given with brightnesses in the blue and in the visual band, B and V. And we were investigating whether B and V is systematically different, or whether it's equal, or if there's no difference between B and V. And we did this based on a hypothesis test where we formulated a null hypothesis, where we computed a critical C score here of this value. So we computed the difference between the two and the mean value. We subtracted the population number, which we assume is zero, and divided by the standard error. Okay. And this gave us a p-value, let me make this a little bit smaller, of 38%. Because again, the c-score of minus 0.87 means we are not a full standard deviation away from the assumedly correct mean value. So this p-value, which is the correct interpretation of this p-value? I pull up a new AD. Let's start it new. Yeah. Visible from your suggestions. Again, let's move through the different statements. So let's look at statement A. So here, the probability, the p-value, means the probability that the average B and V magnitudes are equal. So there are stars, they have B and V magnitudes, and there is something such as the average B and V magnitude difference of a star. If there is something like this, it is a number, because when we look at the stars, at all the stars, there will be some average difference between the two. It's either zero or either a number, but it is a number. So there is no probability involved when we talk about the population properties. The population has a certain property. We might not know it, but it's a number in this case. It's either zero or it isn't, but there is no probability involved. So A and B have like no real meaning because we are talking about something that is not a random quantity. What makes this a little bit confusing is that we make statements like H the null hypothesis, namely that the population difference is zero, and the alternative that the population difference is not zero. These are hypotheses. And we make these hypotheses in order to be able to compute certain probabilities of random outcomes. For example, when we assume that there is no probability, this is our assumption here in the null hypothesis, we can compute the probability of getting a sample of 200 stars, because we assume we know the population quantity, and we can compute the probability of draw a sample from this normal distribution of size 200, and then in this sample find a difference between these magnitudes of at least 0.545, so that's what we found in our sample, and so plus minus on either direction. And this is done by integrating our population, assumed population distribution, from what we measured to the more extreme cases. So this is the shaded area. This is the meaning of the p-value. And under a certain assumption, we can compute the probability and then either discard or not discard this. And so the p-value depends on what we assume is the real value and what we actually have in our sample. Yeah, so that's so accordingly C here is the correct answer, and D, probability of incorrectly rejecting the null hypothesis, if in fact the null hypothesis is true, this is related to what we discussed in the lecture as type 1 and type 2 error. And this is the type 1 error because when we reject the null hypothesis, if our p-value is smaller than some level of significance that we define a priori, which is important, we always have to define this before we do the analysis. And so if it's 5%, then that means if we get an area under this curve smaller than 5% of the total area, this is the probability to get our sample values given some population value. And if it's below this threshold, we might discard this assumption. So if we have a p-value of 1%, we might discard or reject the null hypothesis. But this is but the mistake that we make corresponds exactly to this small area, because there is still this probability to get the result for a given null hypothesis. So for a significance level here of 5%, this is the probability of incorrectly rejecting the null hypothesis. Okay, questions for that. Okay. So let's look at the next one, number three. Let's say you have a test that is done every year, and the mean score of this test is 150 with a standard deviation of 20. Now let's assume you do this test and your C score is 1.5. What was the actual test result that you did? So most of you were voting for A. Yes, so that's exactly, of course, the solution. The C score is, that should actually be, yeah. The C score is how many standard deviations we are away from the mean. So 1.5 standard deviations is 30, so we are at 180. Good. Other questions? If not, then we can move on to the next. Let me close this here to make. So. Now, there's a study that shows that when you listen to music while you study, that might help you. So we have here a study with a sample size of 36. When using music, the mean score was 25 with a standard deviation of 6. The mean score for the sample after the experiment, so with music, was 28. Now we want to, of course, to like analyze this result, and we do this with a test. So what is the corresponding null hypothesis? A couple of more seconds if you quickly want to press the button. Okay. So most of you were for A. I would also argue it's A, however they give D here, so this is something that I like didn't come up with myself. One could argue that D is the correct null hypothesis because it depends on a little bit what the baseline is, because we found a lower score for without music than with music. You can somehow make this statement, but I would actually, what I would also say, A is the correct. But it's important to recall that the null hypothesis needs to be formulated with a like a certain mean value, a certain difference, or so equals to something, because only then we can actually compute probabilities for a certain experiment outcomes. Something like this may worsen or may improve mathematically corresponds to a larger or smaller statement and does not define a hypothetical value for a difference, but a range, okay? So there are now follow-up questions on this scenario here. So let's look at those. What would be the type 1 error? Okay, so we stop, I think. So let's briefly look at the things here. A, concluding that listening to music while studying improves memory, and it's right. This is actually, so here we actually don't do a mistake. So there is no error involved. Then B, which is the right solution, concluding that listening to music while studying improves memory, when it actually doesn't, we recall from the previous problem that the type error is the error of rejecting the null hypothesis, even though it's true. Here our null hypothesis was there is no effect, it doesn't improve our memory. So this means when we conclude that it does, we reject the null hypothesis while it actually doesn't improve the memory. So this is the type 1 error, and the second one is the type 2 error. Good. So the next part, we now do a C-test, and we can conclude based on our C-test. So if you recall, can I pull up? Yeah, these were the observations. And the sample size was 36. And let me pull up the poll here, sorry. Good. So let's look at the solution. So the C test, so we have to compute the C score. We saw we had the null hypothesis that listening does not improve memory. We had the alternative hypothesis that it does improve memory. We have a standard error, which is the standard deviation divided by square root of the sample size, so which is this number, so it's 1. And the C-score was the difference between our observation, our assumed population result, so no difference. So this is actually a 1 here. Which is 3 divided by 1 is 3. So the C-score is 3. And which means we are 3 standard deviations above the mean value. When we assume a critical value of 5%, 1 tailed, then it's 1.65. So we have a larger C-score. We are further away than the critical C-score. So we reject the null hypothesis and say that listening to the music does improve the memory with a 95% confidence. Okay. Questions on this? Okay, if not, then let's move on to the last example. We have a medical test here. So let's assume that you are a medical doctor and you want to reduce the blood sugar level of your patients by changing their diet. You have a mean level of 180 with a standard deviation of 18, so that's your population. And then you have a sample of 9 patients that change their diet and get a lower mean of 175. And he computes a 99% confidence interval. What is the standard error, first of all? Okay. So, look at the solution, which is B. We recall that the standard error is the standard deviation of 18 divided by the square root of the sample size, which was square root of 9. So this is 6. Okay. Now, what's the probability of getting a mean of 175 or even lower after all the patients start dieting? Let's restart. So you have to approximate this, so estimate this roughly now. Okay, so the answer here is, let me briefly stop. The answer is A. Let's look at the explanation. So we have a measurement of 175 and our C value was, the standard error was 6. So the C score is 5 divided by 6, actually minus 0.83. So we are somewhat less than a standard deviation away. And when we look up the corresponding probability, so this is about 20%. So some of you were computing 15%, so that's a little bit low, but okay. So this is in the range. The main point here is to understand that this is what you get and approximately what probabilities this might correspond to. So, which of the following statements is correct? Okay, so the correct answer is B. We recall that this probability here corresponds to, this is the p-value, and that's the probability to get our results, even though the null hypothesis is true. The null hypothesis is there is no effect. This is the mean blood level, blood sugar level, no matter what diet. And there is a 20% chance to get our data, even though there is no effect. So based on a maybe 5% significance level, we have to stick to the null hypothesis and say dieting, we have no, our data is not giving us enough information to conclude that dieting reduces the blood sugar level. Okay. Do you have any questions on these? Okay, so then I have a couple of two more somewhat extended the one is still on Bayesian probabilities. So there's a medical illness called lupus. So that's an autoimmune condition. And there is the statistic that about 2% of the population are suffering from lupus. There is a medical test that is 98% accurate if a person has the disease, and it's 74% accurate if a person does not have the disease. Some of you might know the television series Dr. House, and there is the very frequent quote from him saying, "It's never lupus." So, based on these numbers, do we believe that this is a true statement? And we start by drawing, for example, the probability tree, which looks like this. We had the first two branches that split up because 98% of the population do not have the condition, 2% have. So we randomly pick somebody from the population because we don't know whether somebody is actually afflicted. So this is the first probability step. And then we had a 98% accuracy if it is if the person is ill. So a positive test result here has the probability of 2% times 98% gives about 2% probability. We have the chance that even though this person is ill, our test will show a negative result. So this is 4 times 10 to the minus 4. And we have the possibility, we have an accuracy of 74% of the test if somebody is not sick, so that it correctly gives a negative result here of about 72.52%. And accordingly, a 26% false positive chance, which is then 0.98 times 0.26, which gives us about 0.26% probability here. Now, the statement "it's never lupus" can be answered or can be assessed by looking at what is the probability that a person, when we have a positive, so lupus yes and positive yes, is obtained. So we get this result here. We are on that branch. But what is the chance that we have a positive result? So we are either on this branch or we are on this branch. We don't know. What is the probability that we are actually on the top branch? And this is, according to the Bayes theorem, the probability of having lupus given a positive result. So this is the probability of lupus and positive. So here, divided by positive, which is the sum of this plus this. So it's 2% divided by 2% plus 25.5%. So it's about 7%. So this is the probability that somebody who tests positive actually really has the disease, and which means in 93% of all cases, there is no underlying disease, and this is just a result of the false positive here. So 93% chance that this is true, so that it's not lupus, which is close to it's never lupus. So this was just as an recap of Bayes' probabilities. And if you don't have questions on that, then we move on to the second thing. And this is based on a common English saying, which goes like, "I know something like the back of my hand." And on this TV show Mythbusters, there was once a test where people have had taken photographs of the backs of their hands, and they had to pick the right photo without checking with their hand from a set of 10 pictures. And 11 out of 12 could successfully identify their own back of the hand in this experiment. And then there was a comparison where they had taken photos of the inside, the palm of the hand, and here only 7 out of 12 could successfully identify their own palms. So apparently we much more frequently look at the back of our hand than we do on the inside. So that somehow seems reasonable. And we now go through these numbers. Let's first summarize the result in a table and we compute the proportion of success. So this is the corresponding table. We had 12 candidates in each experiment. In the first one, we had 11 correct and 1 incorrect. And in the second, there was a ratio of 7 to 5. So here the correct proportion was 92% about, and here it was about 58%. And the total, the pooled proportion was 75%. Then we check whether the experiment was independent. Yes, so these were randomly selected people. They got randomly selected pictures together with their own, so independent, yes. The sample size is a little bit small, so this typical success failure condition for the binomial convergent to the normal probability is not met, okay? So we keep that in mind. And then we saw also in the lecture that to check whether this is a significant result, we can, for example, try to model this outcome based on the setup and check whether in a simulation we can get similar results, assuming that, for example, there is no effect. And one possible simulation scheme is summarized here. So we just have 24 basically numbers or positions in a list, and 18 are marked as correct and 6 are marked as wrong, because these are here the total results, the pooled results. Then we shuffle our cards, split them into two groups, because we have one looking at the back of our hand, one looking at the palm, and then we calculate the difference between correct in both groups here, record the number and repeat this. So I do this here basically, so I create 18 list entries that are correct and 6 that are incorrect, and then I put them in one list. And this command basically randomly mixes these 24 numbers, and then I take the first 12 as the ones that look at the back of my hand and the second 12 that look at the palm. And I count the difference between these two correct counts. And I do this 100 times. So let's briefly do this 100,000 times, and the result looks like this. So for every experiment, I get a difference of 4, difference of 0, and so on. And when I do the histogram, this is my result. So we had a difference of what was the difference here between the 2 of 4. A difference of 4, or more extreme, occurred in our experiment. So this is in steps of 2. Occurred 14,000 out of 100,000 times. A difference of 6 occurred 1,300 times, and so on. And when we compute the probability, we can do this, for example, in the following way. We need to compute the probability that for the outcome of looking at the inside of our hand was more extreme than 7 out of 12, even though they were actually randomly guessing. And randomly guessing means successfully picking the correct photo from 10 photos, so a probability of 10%. And we can compute with the binomial distribution the probability for 7 out of 12 candidates, for 8 out of 12, and so on. And this is the probability here for this or more extreme outcome, which is 6 times 10 to the minus 5. We can even do this for the people looking at the back of their hand, and here the probability that this was just a random success, given this probability of randomly guessing here, is even 10 to the minus 10. So based on these numbers, we can conclude the chances that these were actually random results is really slow. But there seems to be a significant difference in how successfully people identify the back of their hand and the inside of their hand. Okay. So this is somehow related to this example in the lectures on the promotion example, and I think we also had a low number example with a similar, I don't recall the example now. But these are possible approaches here. You can also come up with a different simulation scheme, so if you have suggestions, now we can try to do this. And if you don't, then that's as well. And with this, I would like to stop here for the moment. If you have any further comments or questions, we can go through them.